seem to be pretty cumbersome, and so rather than have that be the focus, those provisions were removed. Generally speaking, the office has become an informational and office where homeowners, board members, I guess even property managers if they'd like, can go seek education and information from this office. Was it January 1st that the office was appointed, Jim?
And that group,
yes, the person that was appointed that position is Adrian Levitino, and I would like to say that you know, we do have a good working relationship with the department, which is important. And Representative Neckerts and our other legislators here have been helpful to the industry in working with the department, because there's always something that comes up, and we're going to talk about something else here in a moment. I'll let Pat introduce that, but you know, it seems that it's on a regular basis, particularly during the legislative sessions from January to May, that we have meetings and conference calls with the department. Because I don't want to say we have to set them straight, but we have to educate them really about this industry so that they know, because they may think something makes a lot more sense that we may disagree with. So you know, we need to do that and stay in touch with them. And it's really nice that our legislators will step up, you know, and go with us to these meetings, you know, or get on a conference call.
So it is the ombudsman's person's office is in its infancy right now. And one of the things that they're required to do is file reports with the legislature and let the legislatures and legislators know what's going on, what type of requests they're receiving, what type of inquiries they're receiving. And going forward, that office may change. We've tried to use other states as models. We've seen Colorado use more of this informational-based office, where they provide that information to homeowners. Less focus on dispute resolution or regulatory against associations. So we'll have to continue to review that. We'll have to continue to see how that plays out. And I assume over the next couple of years, as we start to get reports from that office, we'll know really what types of situations they're dealing with. So that kind of summarizes where we've been in 2016. I assume, like I said, a lot of you maybe have already seen some of this legislation or have been aware that it was out there. Let's talk, you know what, before I do this, I'm going to go a little bit out of order to allow Alderman Smith to talk about one other piece of legislation from 2016. Do you mind if we jump out of order a little bit?
Yeah, sure, but how much do you want me to talk about? I can talk about this all day. I think the reason I'm being called on is because of the controversy nationwide, really, over short-term rentals. And last year, after a huge legislative battle inside Chicago City Council, the City of Chicago passed what is being viewed as the most comprehensive regulation of the short-term rental industry, known to us as Airbnb and HomeAway and Vacation Rental by Owner in the country. I guess I just want to start by saying, how many people here live in Chicago or have their places in Chicago? Okay, great. And if you don't, I guess some of this might be relevant for your consideration. You may know that the short-term rental industry began, actually, in Chicago in connection with the World Columbian Exposition of 1893. And all these people were coming to Chicago to come to this convention, and everyone wanted to cash out and start renting their homes for the exposition. And as a result of that, the people, neighbors, got really upset about it, and the City of Chicago changed its zoning code to prohibit short-term rentals and to preserve places where hotels belong to be different from where people lived. And that is what changed in 2016 because of the advent of the short-term rental industry. We have seen that almost overnight in Chicago, well over about 6,000 listings appeared in the City of Chicago within a year or two. And condo associations, particularly not just limited to high rises, but in many units, suddenly found that instead of living next door to a neighbor, they lived next door to people with rolling luggage carts, many of whom were coming into party and used their pools and had bachelor parties, and severe quality of life concerns occurred.
So when the industry began to come to Chicago, many of us started to organize to try to, frankly, ban it in an effort to try to reach some legislation. And did you want me to summarize it a little bit now?
Sure,
go ahead. So what this legislation, what has happened in many other cities worldwide is that many neighborhoods have been eliminated by the lucrative profits of Airbnb, which include the Gracia section of Barcelona, the Garden District of New Orleans now has more short-term rentals than the actual residents living there. So this has become a massive rush to cash. I don't know how it's really gonna work out for those people doing it, but it is truly a concern in every community, not just in the cities, where people allow their homes to be rented out and they become party houses, or sometimes violence has occurred. There was a short-term rental in Morgan Park at the south side of Chicago 2 weekends ago where there was a shooting. So it's become a true quality of life concern. So we began long, difficult negotiations with the industry. In other cities where they have attempted to ban the industry outright, like New York and even parts of San Francisco, this has resulted in litigation that's been very difficult. So the city and city council entered into very long negotiations with Airbnb that have now resulted in some sweeping changes that are fundamental. First of all, after a period of time, all units will have to be registered with the city. This information has never been shared by Airbnb, and if anyone's ever used Airbnb, you realize you know that you don't get the address of the unit until you pay. This has made it very difficult for enforcement, because you can't just go on the internet and see, oh, that unit is, you know, in my block. And indeed, on Airbnb, they often post an exterior picture of a different house than the unit that is being rented in an effort to so-called protect the privacy of their hosts. So the critical path here was to find some way to obtain the actual addresses of these units for enforcement purposes, and that's the fundamental difference between this legislation and legislation nationwide. So a computer interface is being developed, so we're still waiting for that to happen, between Airbnb and other similar platforms in the city that will allow that information to be downloaded. That will create an almost automatic registration process. However, there are some protections for the condo associations. Number one is that there is something called the prohibited business list, that a building of essentially over 3 units can attempt to opt out of short-term rentals at all by creating an affidavit from your building that allows you to say Airbnbs are not, short-term rentals are not allowed in our building. Now, that sounds really wonderful, and today, over 91,000 units in the city of Chicago are on that list since the law was passed. This shows the depth of concern that condominium associations have. But I will tell you, since we're all among friends here, that there is a problem with that limited buildings list, which are your declarations and bylaws. So from a legal perspective, it's an untested question as of yet whether merely opting in to the prohibited buildings list is enough to actually stop a determined owner of a short-term rental unit from listing their unit, and I anticipate litigation in the future. So my first suggestion is if you are either from Chicago or not from Chicago and you are concerned about short-term rentals, is to actually look at your decks, not just your bylaws, to see if that is a prohibition. Many, many places prohibit rentals under a year, which usually does it. And this is a concern to your property values and your neighbors and your quality of life. That's the first. The second piece of advice is if you are not from the city of Chicago, check the zoning code in your town to see whether or not short-term rentals are already banned. that might give you a leg up. But the prohibited building list is meant to be a deterrent and sort of put people on notice, put guests on notice that they're not welcome in that unit. The other major aspect to the law is that there is, it does place certain limits on the number of units that can be rented, even if they can buy it right. Single-family homes that are owned by a homeowner are allowed to be short-term rentals. That's a problem with the law that we're still facing. If it is up to four units, the law prohibits only one of those four units can be listed on some platform. And in a larger building, it's 25% of the units or six, whichever is less. Now again, this law is completely untested, but it is designed to place some sort of limit on the number of short-term rentals. There's also a fairly robust enforcement mechanism, and it does allow an awful lot of due process for registrants. So for example, today, the vast majority of the 6,000 units that are operating in the city of Chicago are not registered. They don't have a vacation rental license. They don't have a bed and breakfast license. They are essentially operating completely illegally. This law is an attempt to bring those units into the fold one way or another, to get their addresses and then either take action to strike them from the registry or to legalize them. So I can talk about this an awful lot. I'm happy to take questions about it. But I think that I will note that among the legislation I see here that was defeated in 2016 was a law introduced by someone who is clearly aligned with the industry, maybe not, to say, as a matter of state law, that there can be no regulation of the short-term rental industry that is different from bed and breakfast industry, which would be a sweeping allowable short-term rentals in everyone's units across the city, across the state. So I think this is a legislative issue that I hope your association is going to continue to place a very close watch on and to see what your what your members look like. So that's how I'm going to deal with that.
Okay. Thank you, Alderman Smith. I just want to mention that there's also a state piece of legislation in the state legislature that addresses this again this year. There was one last year that we stopped. And the sponsor last year introduced it as a business-friendly piece of legislation, and when I explained to her what it did, she decided not to call the bill. This year, the bill is sponsored by the Assistant Majority Leader in the Illinois Senate, a Democrat, which was a little more worrisome to me, to us. And so in talking with him, and this happens a lot in Springfield, a lobbyist brought this to his attention and asked him to introduce the bill. A lobbyist hired by Expedia. So I shouldn't say the senator won't call the law. I shouldn't say that at all. But he understands that this industry, not only the community associations industry, but the hotel industry that I also represent, is opposed to this. So I would think that bill won't move, but it would preempt Chicago and other local municipalities from doing anything, which would kind of stop everything that we've, that Michelle, that Alderman Smith has accomplished with this, with the Chicago ordinance.
Thank you. And when we get to the question and answer part, if anybody wants to ask any questions on that, please feel free. We're going to move on to some of the 2017 legislation real quick. There's a couple of different types of pending legislation this year. I think when I did a search for associations and condominiums, it's 79 different pieces of legislation, or the name popped up. Now, a lot of those were regulatory bills that were merely mentioned in various acts. But there are some pretty significant pieces of substantive legislation that have already been introduced that we're going to be addressing. Four bills by CAI, two sponsored by Senator Hastings, two bills sponsored by Representative Neckritz, and some other matters that we're looking into. I really broke it down into four different categories this year in terms of different types of bills. Collection-related bills, governance bills, items that we kind of generally refer to as cleanup bills, and then regulatory bills. So if I could just quickly talk about three different collection-related bills. And by collection-related, I generally mean the use of the Forcible Entry and Detainer Act by associations to be able to collect unpaid assessments from meter donors or unpaid common expense. As you may or may not know, these are generally referred to in the law as joint actions, meaning associations are seeking two different things. They're seeking the damages for the unpaid common expense plus attorney's fees and costs, and seeking possession of the unit. There are time frames, there are limitations of the ability to recover possession of the unit. What I always say to my clients, and what most of my clients and managers echo back to me, is we don't want the unit, we want the money, and we want you to keep paying. Quite frankly, that's much better for the community. We want people to stay in their homes, but this is a mechanism that's out there. I will let you know, Illinois is the only state in the country that allows this mechanism. Why? Because it's expedient, and it allows associations who are suffering to be able to get these units or get the money, which is what they really want. Other states engage in foreclosure. We're just at a seminar in January. Nevada engages in non-judicial foreclosure of assessment liens, meaning it happens outside of the presence of a judge with bidders, sometimes in a law office, sometimes in a management company. You can imagine some of the issues that they experience with lien collection. So the first bill is House Bill 2667. And what the bill has done is it's kind of a cleanup bill, kind of a collection bill. It modifies the portions of the Forcible Entry and Detainer Act to clarify that it's no longer just a quote-unquote common interest, undefined common interest community. The use of the Forcible Entry and Detainer Act shall be by those master associations as defined by the Condominium Property Act, condominium associations, and common interest communities defined by the Common Interest Community Association Act. Not only defined by, but subject to. So the one thing we all need to be aware of, if this legislation moves and continues to pass, you and your common interest community, you must be subject to the Common Interest Community Association Act. Meaning, if you are exempt under the Common Interest Community Association Act, you either need to make yourself subject to that, or you may not be able to use the Forcible Entry and Detainer Act to collect unpaid assessments. That doesn't mean you can't use lien foreclosures. Doesn't mean you can't use small claims. But be aware of this piece of legislation. The next bill is House Bill 3755. And I know people on the panel are skipping around a little bit, so I apologize for that. There were three bills introduced last year similar to House Bill 3755. Now it's one bill. There are a couple of critical things that this bill is attempting to do. It's attempting to modify Section 9.2 of the Condominium Property Act. That bill generally permits associations, when a unit owner is in default, to pursue that default and charge the attorney's fees as a result of those defaults back to the unit owner and have that become part of the common expense. One of the things that this bill attempts to do is it excludes the ability of an association to charge back the statutory demand notice required to use the Forcible Entry and Detainer Act to that unit owner as part of the common expense. Meaning, in practice, when a lawyer sends out the demand notice, that's required by the Forcible Entry and Detainer Act, and as courts have said, our subject matter jurisdiction, meaning we can't file a lawsuit if we haven't sent this letter out. Those amounts, so the unit owner who hasn't paid their assessments cannot be charged back to that unit owner. We're opposing this legislation. The other thing that it does is it codifies that a unit owner defending collection matters, covenant enforcement matters, rule matters against their association, if they, and this is the language from the statute, substantially prevail, they get their attorney's fees against the association. Which I've yet to read in a declaration or set of bylaws for any of the communities I represent. So it changes that. The legislation is being described as leveling the playing field. My personal opinion is the design is to tilt the playing field. These are people who are not in compliance or are in default, and we are trying to make sure that they don't have to pay the attorney's fees and they can use this against associations. So.
Can I jump in just for a second? This is one of those kind of bills that can get traction in Springfield because the sponsor will push this bill hard. And, you know, on the surface, it sounds like a homeowner protection bill. You know, and legislators who aren't real familiar with it well, may sign on before sponsoring the bill. And that's how you get traction in the capital. So, you know, we have to keep an eye on this bill, and it's, you know, it's something that could pass. And we will meet with the sponsor and try to see if we can work something out. But, you know, I just wanted to mention that because that's how things work in Springfield. And you know, those that wouldn't know what this bill does at first would say, oh, yeah, that sounds like a good bill for homeowners. You know, but really it's not, you know, and that is just a matter of educating, you know, the legislators in Springfield.
And one other collection-related bill, and Representative Kifferwood can probably comment on this just based upon the demographics of her the homeowners associations. There's a Senate Bill 927 that imposes certain caps on homeowners associations before they can initiate certain collection actions. And the caps are $500 before you can file a lien and $1,000 before you can file suit. I'm sure some of the communities in your area would take years to meet those thresholds, wouldn't it?
It can, and sometimes it can't. My homeowners association is about $700 a year for our due. So it really depends on, we have various homeowners associations, obviously, with various levels of fees. So it could take a long time. It could just take a year, but I would say at minimum maybe a year to accumulate those kind of fee limitations. So it would take a while.
With some of the homeowners association I live in is $56 a year. We maintain the pond. We don't even have a sign. We contribute to maintain the pond.
Oh, I have a pool. I love my pool. Thank you.
It would take 10 years before the association could initiate any lien on the property, just the lien. It would take 20 years before the association could initiate litigation. And maybe you'd say $56, big deal. Yeah, it isn't that big of a deal, but there's only 50 homes in our community. So if half of those homes or 3/4 of those homes aren't paying, that really affects the underlying budget for some of these homeowners associations. And if it's years and years and years, and anybody who's done collection know, if you don't ask, they don't pay. So people are more than happy to not send in their coupons. Any manager who's never heard the phrase, well, I never got a coupon or I never got an invoice. I'm sure you probably don't get the phone calls of, I know I live in a homeowners association, I really want to make sure I pay my dues on time, so can you tell me where to send it? Instead it's, I never got anything, you never sent it to me, I never got an invoice. The other thing that this legislation does, besides putting those two caps, is it requires that before the lien or the lawsuit get filed, there has to be notice and an opportunity for a hearing for the defaulting unit owner. I'm not really sure how that hearing goes. You haven't paid. I know. But it's a legislative requirement. So that's Senate Bill 927 that we're continuing to look at. Those are the collection-related bills. Let's get into some of the governance bills. Representative Neckritz has agreed to introduce two bills for us, House Bill 2400 and House Bill 2401. Even though they're out of order, I'd like to talk about 2401 first. That's a CAI-sponsored bill that really affects two different substantive things. Let me just, before I let her speak, just kind of address them. One is defining what a class of membership is. This has been, in my opinion, used as a shield and a sword throughout the various years. Well, we can't do that because we have to have one class of membership. We have to have one class of membership. Okay, well, does that mean that, you know, there can't be certain rules for tenants that are different than the rules for owners? There can't be certain limitations for different types of people who might have a different interest? So the statute attempts to clarify that we want to make this shall have one class of voting membership. The other portion of the statute that we're seeking to change is Section 15. And this has gotten, you know, ironically, I remember Jeff calling me last year and Senator Connelly had a bill and said, we want to change Section 15 of the Condominium Property Act. And I literally had to grab my statute and said, what is Section 15? In the last 12 months, I've heard a lot more about it. And I know Cranes has written about it. I know there have been seminars about it. And there have been discussions about it. It's where the building
the entire building or the entire condominium association gets bought. And you are no longer a condominium association, now you are a different portion of the property. Right now, there are a couple of different tiers that need to be met before that can happen. If it's two units, it's by majority. If it's three units, or I'm sorry, if it's, yeah, three units, it's two-thirds, and if it's four units or more, it's 75%. The legislation that's been introduced and passed Judiciary last week.
Passed.
Right, it's dual bills. There's two different bills running. Adds a fourth tier. And it says 4 to 6 units, 75%, 7 or more, 85%. We're just trying to move the threshold up before people have to sell their units. Representative Beckers, anything else on this?
It has passed out of the House Committee and out of the Senate Committee. There was not a lot of discussion in the committee or concerns raised, so it doesn't appear to me that it will be controversial as it comes to the floor in many ways, because it has that sound to it, and I think it actually does protect homeowners and unit owners. So I think it should be fine, but I appreciate the your support and being in touch with your legislator about it, because I just want to make sure.
Yes, go ahead.
I'll just mention that in the Senate Judiciary Committee, there were questions, and it passed unanimously, but the questions really were focusing on the value of the individual units. You know, and it's interesting, the chairman of the Senate Judiciary Committee owns a 3-bedroom, 2.5-bath condo. And you know, there's other people on the committee that I think are in condominiums as well. But, you know, it's a valid question. You know, he said to me, Jeff, you know, I would like to think that my condo's worth more than yours, or not mine. And he said, more than someone else's. And I said, well, I would too. I'd like to think the same thing about my 3-bedroom, 2.5 condo. And he said, well, you know, how do you do that? You know, the valuation, you know, someone comes in, you get three appraisers, you know, you look at the building, you come up with the price, and then you take. So, you know, he was interested in the process of how you get to that valuation of a unit. So that's a discussion that we'll continue to have with the chairman of the committee, you know, who's a powerful person in Springfield, to make sure that he's, you know, okay with how that proceeds.
Well, and one of the areas where this came up were people who maybe bought their units in 2005, and they paid a substantial amount of money for these units, and now they were the 25% disaffected unit owners, and Senator Connelly talked to us specifically about a property in Naperville, where he had some constituents who said, we don't want to sell, and now that we've done the valuation on our units, we're all upside down. But because 75% of the people, who a lot of whom were investors, had decided they wanted to sell and get out, these people were compelled under the act for the value of their units to sell. So we're not really changing that aspect of it. We're just trying to increase the threshold a little bit, where you're going to have to be at 85%. So more than a substantial majority of the community would have to. Discussion that started this week. Representative Nekritz and myself and Jeff Dixon were on a call with the Department of Financial and Professional Regulations, and they have been asked by the governor's office to cut budgets from their department, like every other administrative department. So what did they do? They looked around and they saw there's 1,800 licensed managers in the state of Illinois. And they said, let's introduce a bill, at least to start the discussion, to repeal manager licensing. Representative Beckers,
I think Pat summed it up pretty accurately. They basically said two things. One, it's barrier to entry, and which all licensing is, you know, whether you're a doctor or a nurse or an association manager. And secondly, it's a cost-cutting measure. And I'm sympathetic, not really sympathetic to the first, but I am sympathetic to the second, because we have real fiscal woes at the state of Illinois. So I'm trying to figure out where's the right balance.
And I mean, this, I have my opinion, Representative Nekritz has her opinion, the people from the department have their opinion. Maybe we can even do this as a community. Show of hands, who wants it repealed?
Who wants it to stay?
There are a lot of not voters.
Yeah. Who didn't vote at all?
Your failure to vote will be like consent.
which way? Well, this is a discussion that we're going to continue to have. But again, this is a bill that's already been introduced. If you have an opinion on it, it will be in committee. It will be voted on. It is a bill that's originating from the Senate. And for anyone who doesn't know, there's a mechanism on the state of Illinois' legislative website where you can find committee hearings, you can track bills. Of those bills that you track, you can submit witness slips. It's really just a couple of clicks. And you can submit a witness slip and say, I support this or I oppose this. So all of these representatives who served in the committees can, and Senator Hastings can tell you, that's one of the questions that gets asked when a bill gets called before committee. Have we received any witness slips? Who are they from? And what are the numbers? Who's in support? Who's in opposition? And that is a consideration, because if we don't speak on some of these issues, and a representative introduces a bill or a senator introduces a bill to the committee and no one has any thoughts on it, okay, we'll let it get to the House floor or Senate floor and have a vote. So those are a couple of things that we need to continue to track and we need to continue to be aware of. Before we get to questions, I'm just gonna talk about a couple of cases. Anybody who has gotten material, there's a list of cases in there that have been decided in 2016. I tried to detail what's going on with those cases. Some significant things to consider, though. There are more cases that I have read about assessment collection that have made it to the appellate court level than ever before. And this is my 24th year of practicing law. So these are becoming more and more significant issues. And a lot of what the courts are saying, like I had indicated before, is follow your procedures. Follow the statute, follow your procedures. If your declaration doesn't allow you to recover attorney's fees, you can't get attorney's fees. If your declaration requires you to take certain steps before you find this person, take those steps. If the law requires that you vote at an open meeting to institute a fine, before that letter goes out to that unit owner saying you've been fined, that vote shall have occurred. You won't be able to collect those amounts. There's a lien foreclosure case where an association for parking violations that seemed to me to be totally admitted sent out a letter before they had to vote. Said this person had been fined $4,000. And the court turned around and said, that letter and that fine and the $15,000 of subsequent legal fees that were incurred after that are all void and unenforceable. And the association, since they didn't follow their procedures, can't collect those amounts. The other thing, and this kind of goes to the short-term rentals. And one of the things Alderman Smith was talking about is make sure you know what your government documents actually say. A case we talked about briefly last year because it was decided right before the trade show was the Stobie case. If you haven't read about that, please do in either the materials or online somewhere. Stobie case involved an association who enacted rules and regulations to cap leasing. Rules and regulations. That should be fine, right? Remember what Alderman Smith said, though. Make sure it's in your bylaws and make sure it's in your declaration. Before you're saying that you're on this prohibited building list, make sure that that's what your documents actually provide. Now, there's a difference between short-term rental prohibitions and total leasing prohibitions. A lot of declarations provide leases must be more than 30 days or 6 months or a year. Not all declarations provide you can't have leases or you have a cap of 20%. Know what that is, but my suggestion to you, if you're in a condominium in the state of Illinois and your declarations mention the lease, say the word tenant, reference at all that there are lease rights or tenant rights, and you try to cap or eliminate leasing by a rule, that rule will be found to be invalid. The court said in that case, that contradicts the terms of the declaration. So what do? You amend your declaration. And you amend your declaration, you can actually accomplish those leasing restrictions. But it's a very important case. And it's a little bit different than what had been the state of law since about 1992. Let me just touch on, but you know what? Why don't we see if we can get some questions? And if I have some more time to touch on something else, I'll go ahead. But anybody have any questions for anybody on the panel or myself or on any of these matters? Yes, ma'am. We'll try to get a microphone over to you so yes, everybody can hear your question. If you could wait just one second.
I will bring a microphone. Just raise your hand. We'll go over here.
declaration is silent on leasing, can you cap it in your rules if there's no mention of leasing in the decks?
I would say that that court opinion would stand for the proposition of yes, but be very careful as to what no mention of leasing is. Because in that case, the mention of leasing was very de minimis. And the court said, we don't think so. Now, as any attorney will tell you, that is really a case where bad facts make bad law. This was a small association where the board retroactively attempted to punish a unit owner for leasing their unit and then fine them several thousands of dollars for leasing violations. So I don't think the court was too thrilled with the association's approach in the matter to begin with. And I think they found a way to create law that said, well, here's a provision where it says tenant, here's a provision where it says lease, leasing must be okay. So be careful as to, it doesn't necessarily have to say leasing is completely permissible. It could mention lease or tenant.
It's interesting you talk about funding for things, and I understand there still has been no definitive funding source for the ombudsman office, but now we're talking about eliminating licensing. I find that kind of interesting.
You're on the same phone call, obviously. That was actually one of our first points on the phone call, that we found it very interesting that at the same time you're creating an ombudsperson legislation and creating an opportunity to discuss disputes or complaints or something that the board is doing or that other members are doing, the suggestion from the same department is to eliminate all kinds of manager licensing. We brought that to their attention.
And with regard to the ombudsman, the department, when we were negotiating the revisions to the act, this was a question we raised, and they seemed very comfortable and assured us that they were going to be able to do that within their available revenues. So it is a little ironic.
Well, I think it comes down to money, and it comes down to budgets, like you said. And this, it appears this is coming from the governor's office. And as Pat said earlier, they're trying to do what they can with what they have. But it's been made clear to them, I think, that right at this moment, we have a problem with the legislation. And I will say real briefly, the sponsor of the bill in the Senate is a friend of the industry, and she's the president of her homeowners association. She was approached to sponsor the bill because she's an assistant Republican leader in the Senate. You know, the governor's a Republican, so they go to, you know, the governor's office would go to someone like that who could shepherd that bill through. But she's reached out to Representative Negrets right away and to me, you know, and she wants to work with us too. So I think there's a real opportunity for the industry.
And you're not just picking on us. There's, I think, 13 separate licenses that they're seeking to repeal and a number of others that they're seeking to scale back.
All right, we've got one over here. Yeah, good morning, Pat. You mentioned that an exempt association under CECA must subject themselves to in order to be able to collect their portion out the budget according to the terms, so therefore we are, or is there another method that is required?
Okay, that's a great question. One of the things I just want to make clear is that is just a bill right now that's been introduced to define the entity that can use the Forcible Entry and Detainer Act as one that is subject to the Common Interest Community Association Act. So when you look to Section 75 of the Common Interest Community Association Act, it deals with exemptions. And in there, it exempts associations that have 10 units or less or a budget of $100,000 or less. They are exempt statutorily. They can agree by a majority of the directors or the members to subject their association to the Common Interest Community Association Act and its terms and provisions. So what would it require? It would require an act on behalf of the Board of Directors would be the simplest approach. Right, and so a resolution that would be passed at an open meeting and then obviously following all the provisions of the Common Interest Community Association Act, which my guess is they're probably doing pretty close to that anyway.
We've had the attorneys for our associations be successful in enforcing rules that cap leasing in some instances, and they advise that in the event the declaration of bylaws in the section covering leasing includes additional language subject to reasonable rules and regulations, the judges have found that the cap of leasing in the rules is not a restriction but actually a regulation. And absent that language in the deck and bylaws, then an amendment is their only option. Would would you concur with that, or have there been changes to where that might actually be overruled as well?
Not to belabor the issue, but just a little history. In 1992, there was a case called Apple II Condominium Association, and in that case, it was an amendment to the declaration that restricted leasing, and the unit owner who owned prior to that amendment challenged it, said, you can't retroactively enforce this against me. I owned when it wasn't here. And what the court said in that case is, yes, and one of the things that your declaration said was, it could be amended, and it was amended, so that provision changed. So that right you might have had previously, you no longer have as long as the association followed that. In that case, the court mentioned two different types of analysis. And in talking about the declaration amendment, they said, we're going to give great deference to this amendment because it was adopted by the membership. They said in that case, if it was merely a rule, we would give less deference to it. We would check its reasonableness and whether or not we think it's actually furthering a goal. So amendment provision, lots of deference, a rule just adopted by the board, less deference. Everybody from 1992 said, okay, well, this case recognizes that by rule, you can limit leasing as long as it's reasonable. What the Stobie Court said, and this is a decision that's only about a year old right now, so, and it's from the First District Appellate. Okay, what the Stobie Court said was, and admittedly, I haven't read all of the terms of their declaration, but what the Stobie Court said was, if that declaration contains some reference to the fact that there are rights to lease, there may be restrictions that you can take away those rights. Now, the way that case was, they put a 20% leasing cap in there, and this unit owner would have been over the 20%, so they were eliminating this unit owner from the case, basically. This unit owner wouldn't have been able to rent. So it wasn't just a rule about how many tenants you can have in there, or what kind of parking they can have, how many animals. It would have been an absolute prohibition against them, and they were being fined for it. So I'm not quite sure. I assume based upon these two cases, as we continue to explore this at the appellate court level, we'll find out how far they can go. But I guess my recommendation would be, if you can get a declaration amendment, that's the safest way to do it.
Okay, Pat, we've got time for one more thing.
Okay. So
all the way back.
Just a quick suggestion and question. I'm a realtor also, and I know that there's things that the our state legislatures, or there's rules that are pertaining to us, or things that are going to change. We have a call to action. So I don't know, CAI or industry-wide, it's really, do you agree with this? Basically what you were saying, to get their voices heard is a mechanism by where they email us. So we have a, put our name and address in there, click the box, yes, I agree with this, they give the whole proposition. I don't know if you are familiar with those, I'm sure you know. I think that'd be a good way to get everybody's opinion on the licensing.
CAI National does actually run that in conjunction, and we can be in touch with CAI National and say, hey, we have an issue that's come up. Can you send out a call to action to everybody by virtue of email? And if you haven't received it, Cheryl, they can sign up on the website to get those call to actions, correct? Or it's just, if you're a member of CAI, you automatically, if you're a CAI member, you automatically get those.
Can you go beyond that? They get the, because there are managers that are licensed that aren't members of CAI. You know, kind of.
See Cheryl for membership.
Yeah.
I just want to chime in on that. We call those robo emails. So when you sign on, it's the exact same email with just a different name on it. It's much more poignant and effective to either write a personal email that's not just stock language from your association. They do a good job giving you the language, but if you take it and write it personal and let us know that you're actually taking the time instead of just going to a website and writing a name and clicking a box to actually give us specific instances or details, or give a call and actually leave a personal message at our offices or come to one of our meetings. I know we have a lot of constituents. So that one-on-one contact is so much more effective than if I get 200 emails with the same subject in the same language and the same organization. I'm not disrespecting the organization,
no.
But I'm just saying the personal touch is so much more effective. It is effective to get the auto-generated emails, but a personal touch is so much more effective when actually telling your personal story.
And that's something I hear from Jeff probably three times a week, which is, that's great, Matt. Now you've offered a comment on this bill. Provide me with an example. Provide me how this actually, information as to how this affects a unit owner, anybody, and how they're dealing with it. Because just having some type of, you know, legal analysis or esoteric comment on it in and of itself doesn't resonate. Thank you, everybody, for your time and your attention.